Good to go, CUNY TV. We're now in public session. You guys should be up.
Okay. You have to read all of that stuff again.
Yeah, unfortunately for the record. Okay, I'll try to do it fast. Members of the Board of Trustees Committee on Faculty, Staff, and Administration, please respond present when you hear your name. Lorraine Cortez Vasquez.
Present.
Vice Chairperson Ken Sunshine.
Present.
Trustee Una Clark. No, okay. Trustee Myra Linares Garcia.
Present.
Great. Professor Karen Coughlin.
Present.
Terrific. Professor Maureen Matarese.
Present.
Okay. Amber Rivero. Nope. So we don't have, and I see Trustee Pecan. Okay. So you have a quorum. Public meeting of the Committee on Faculty, Staff, and Administration is now called.
Okay.
Executive Order 202 declaring a state of emergency in response to the COVID-19 March 13, 2020, Governor Cuomo issued Executive Order 202.1, which included a suspension service. Article 7 of the Public Officers Law, to the extent necessary to permit any public body to meet and take such actions authorized by the law without permitting in public, in-person access to meetings and authorizing such meetings to be held remotely by conference call or similar service, provided that the public has the ability to view or listen such proceeding and that such meetings are recorded and later transcribed. In accordance with the executive order, this board meeting is being held via video conference with a live stream found at the CUNY Board of Trustees website. We're also testing out a new closed captioning feature, which you'll see on the bottom of your screen. A copy of the calendar and agenda is also available online at the CUNY Board of Trustees website. Additional items may be added during the meeting. As a reminder, please mute your audio so we can ensure that everyone can be heard. I would like to take a roll call attendance for members of the Chancellery. Members of the Chancellery, please respond present when you hear your name. Chancellor Felix Matos Rodriguez.
Present.
General Counsel and Senior Vice Chancellor for Legal Affairs, Derek Davis.
Present.
Executive Vice Chancellor and Interim University Provost, Daniel Lemons.
Present.
Executive Vice Chancellor and Chief Operating Officer, Hector Batista.
Present.
Senior Vice Chancellor, Glenda Grace.
Present.
Vice Chancellor, Dorian. Interim Vice Chancellor, Andrea Shapiro Davis.
Present.
Okay. I see your President Thomas II-Negby.
Present.
Ann Lokes, the Provost and Senior VP for Academic Affairs at Brooklyn College.
Present.
Tony List, the Provost and Senior VP for Academic Affairs at City College.
Present.
Okay, and Yi Lee, Provost and Vice President for Academic Affairs.
Present.
Yi Lee?
Yeah, present.
Great. Elizabeth Hendry, Provost and Vice President for Academic Affairs at Queens College.
Present.
Elizabeth. Frank Wu, President of Queens College.
Yeah, I'm here.
Great. Nana Ama Ampa, Executive Assistant at the School of Labor and Urban Studies. Maybe that was for you.
That was for me, yeah. Greg,
that's what I thought. Okay, I got you, Greg. Yeah, that's... I had said that to somebody, it didn't make sense. Okay, Gladys Schrinmaker, Associate Dean of Academic Affairs at the School of Labor and Urban Studies.
Present.
Okay, Dave Wu, President of College.
Present.
No, David. Okay, Eugene Son, the Executive, oh, there we are. Thanks, yes, David. Eugene Son, the Executive, and I was had a late, and I don't know if he came in. I had a late note about President William Fritz. Is President Fritz on? No. Okay. It's all you, Lorraine.
Okay, great. Thank you. We have 12 items to go through today. And you know, because of we're on Zoom, we're asking you to only respond if you would like to abstain or oppose a particular item. Silence means approval. All right, so I'm going to start with the first item, which is the item action 1A, which is the approval of the minutes of May 3rd, 2021 meeting. I move the approval of action 1A. Do I have a second?
So move. Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? Hearing none, I'm calling a vote. Hearing no abstentions or oppositions, this motion is carried. Policy item 1B1, which is a resolution to approve the Committee on Faculty and Staff and Administration report. I call on Vice Chancellor Dorian Gloria to provide further background on this item.
Thank you. The CFSA report reflects 147 employee actions, including 75 fellowship leaves and 65 faculty appointments and reappointments with tenure.
Thank you very much. I approve the approval of this amendment. Can I get
Second. Dorian, you're supposed there was an amendment, I understood, that you wanted to make to the report.
I thought there was two, but she didn't, yep. So I'm just moving.
Yep, go ahead.
All right, so Myra, did you do the second?
Yes, I was doing a second.
Thank you so much, Trustee Linares Garcia. We're going to call this for a vote.
This is Karen Coghlan, the faculty representative. I'm going to abstain on this one because this report identifies me as being awarded tenure. So in order to avoid any conflict of interest, I will abstain on it.
Thank you very much for that, but we trust your integrity and you didn't have to abstain. Hearing no other abstentions or oppositions, this vote carries. Thank you so much. Item 1B2 is a resolution to amend the governance plan of Eugenio Maria de Hostos Community College at the City University of New York. So I'm going to call on Assistant General Counsel Hillary Klein to provide brief further comments on this item.
We had a late comment. I think Eugene Son from Hostos is going to be presenting instead.
Okay, great. Thank you for that.
Yep.
For that amendment.
Hey, Eugene? Good evening. Yes, good evening. And thank you for this opportunity to present Hostos Community College's latest proposed set of charter amendments. The Hostos Charter of Governance was adopted initially by the BOT in 1992. And has since undergone several changes, the last being in 2018. The Hostos Senate, as per the Hostos Charter of Governance, has approved the most recent amendments and has the support of the President, Daisy Coco de Filipis. The most recent amendments for your consideration are for the most part technical nature, clarifying parts of the charter, removing outdated language, and do not seek to make substantial changes to the Hostos Charter governance structure. First, the amendments create an expectation that the Hostos representatives to the University Faculty Senate will attend all UFS meetings. All UFS representatives who are full-time faculty members are automatically members of the Hostos College Senate. There is already an expectation that these UFS representatives attend Hostos College Senate meetings, and this imposes that same expectation on meetings of the University Faculty Senate. In addition, the UFS representatives would need to give notice of any non-attendance so that alternatives could attend in their stead. Similarly, these representatives would be required to attend the meetings of the College Senate committees to which they are appointed, and they would also have to give notice of any non-attendance. Secondly, the amendments memorialize a current practice of the Academic Standards Committee, namely adjudicating grade appeals that have been denied at the department level. In addition, the proposed amendments revise the name of the current Affirmative Action Committee to the newly named Committee on Affirmative Action, Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion. And the new amendments would also expand the role of that committee as well. Thirdly, because counselors are now higher education officers rather than faculty members, with one exception, the amendments remove the requirement to have faculty representation who are counselors as representatives to the Hostos College Senate. HEO counselors are separately elected to represent the HEOs in the College Senate currently. Fourth, the amendments change the time period for regular elections for adjunct faculty members, which are currently held in May, to the fall semester. And finally, the amendments propose a number of language changes, namely pronouns are changed to gender neutral pronouns, and there are other minor edits of language that are suggested to clarify the charter. Hostos is currently undergoing its accreditation process, and approval would be greatly beneficial. Hostos Community College respectfully requests that these charter amendments are approved. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor. We would ask, I would like to move this item. Do I have a second?
Second, Linares Garcia.
Thank you, Trustee Garcia. Any discussion? Not, we're moving this for a vote. Hearing no abstentions or objections, this item carries. Policy item 1B3. It's a resolution to appoint Dr. Linda Essig as Provost and Senior Vice President for Academic Affairs at Baruch College at the City University of New York. I call on Vice Chancellor Dorian Garcia again to provide brief comments on this item.
Thank you. Linda Essig has served as Dean of the College of Arts and Letters at California State University, Los Angeles, since 2018, and served as Director of Enterprise and Entrepreneurship Programs of the Herberger Institute for Design and the Arts at Arizona State University from 2015 to 2018. Dr. Essig was the Director of the School of Theater and Film at Arizona State University from 2006 to 2010. And previously served as chair of the Department of Theater and Drama and director of University Theater at University of Wisconsin-Madison. Dr. Essig's selection as Provost and Senior Vice President for Academic Affairs is the result of a nationwide search from which she emerged as the candidate selected from a diverse pool of candidates that rendered four elite finalists. Dr. Essig holds a PhD in public administration and public policy from Arizona State University and an MFA in design for stage and screen from New York University. The chancellor highly recommends this appointment effective July 1st, 2021 at an annual salary of $295,000.
I move the approval of this policy. Do I have a second?
Second, Linares Garcia.
Gracias. Thank you, Trustee Garcia. Now that we have any discussion? Hearing none, we'll call a vote. Hearing no objections or abstention, this vote carries. Congratulations, Dr. Linda Essig. I've now moved to policy item 1B4, which is a resolution to appoint Teresa Bandos as Distinguished Professor at City College of the City University of New York. And I call on Interim Executive Vice Chancellor Danielle Lemons to provide brief comments on this item.
Thank you, Chair Cortez Vasquez. I'm pleased to present these candidates from City College, Teresa Bandos, is an internationally renowned authority on non-engineered carbon-based materials and composites for environmental and energy-related applications. She's published over 380 peer-reviewed journal articles, co-authored a book, edited a book, and has 12 book chapters. Dr. Bandosh is among the top researchers worldwide in the area of surface chemistry of porous carbons. Prior to her appointment at CUNY, she served as an assistant professor at the University of Mining and Metallurgy from 1984 to 1991. And I would like to invite my colleague, Provost and Senior Vice President of Academic Affairs, Tony Liss of City College, to say more about this action.
I don't have much to add. Thank you, EVC Lemons. We're happy to have provided Dan's inaugural run at this part of the talk. Professor Bandosh is a terrific and really exceptionally accomplished chemist, and she's working in environmental chemistry, which is as topical as it gets. And she's been waiting a long time for this, and we're very happy to have had it brought to committee. And that's all.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for those added comments. I move the approval of item 1B4. Do I have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Trustee Sunshine. Any discussion? Hearing none, we'll carry, we'll go to vote. Hearing no abstentions or objections, congratulations, Teresa Bosch, Bandos, for your distinguished professorship at City University, at City College. Policy item 1B5 is a resolution to appoint Cecilia Maria Gonzalez Mahieu as Distinguished Professor at Queens College of the City University of New York. And I'm going to call again on Interim Executive Vice Chancellor Daniel Lemons to provide brief further comments on this item. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Cecilia Maria Gonzalez Mahieu is a world-leading authority in submarine paleoseismology, earthquake geology, marine geology, and biogenic sedimentation. Wow. She's published over 50 peer-reviewed journal articles, over 30 book chapters, and over 130 peer-reviewed international abstracts and workshops, of which over 40 included her students. Dr. Gonzalez Mahieu was elected Fellow of the Geological Society of America in 2019, and serve as a distinguished lecturer in the International Ocean Discovery Program. She pioneered paleoseismological analysis in marine sediments and has gone on to become renowned for her contributions. Her pioneering work finding seismic signals in the sedimentary record is not only important for science, but also societal planning. I invite my colleagues, President Frank Wu and Provost and Vice President for Academic Affairs, Elizabeth Henry of Queens College, to say more about this proposed action.
Hi, great to be here. I would invite our Provost Betsy Henry to say more. I would add that in addition to the just tremendous qualifications that the candidate has, she also would bring a great diversity to the ranks of distinguished professor, being, I believe, first Chicana distinguished professor, certainly at Queens College. Betsy, would you like to say a word or two in addition?
I would echo what EVC Lemon said about the practical applications of this work for, say, talking about building infrastructure to protect the world from earthquakes. She was called to Japan after the Fukushima earthquake, and we're very proud of her and pleased to nominate her for distinguished professor.
Thank you very much. I move approval of this item 1B5. Do I have a second?
Second, Linares Garcia.
Thank you, Trustee Garcia. Any discussion? We'll call this for a vote. Hearing no abstentions or oppositions, this motion has carried. Congratulations on that impressive bio, but also congratulations on the appointment, Cecilia Maria Gonzalez McHugh. Thank you for being part of our ranks. Now we will go to item 1B6, which is a resolution to award Sophia Apkenkar with early tenure at the City University of New York School of Labor and Urban Studies with an application of bylaw 6.2C3. Now again, I'll call on Executive Vice Chancellor Daniel Lemons to provide brief comments on this item. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Sophia Picard's publication record is extensive for a scholar at her point in her career. She's published a pathbreaking first book, 14 peer-reviewed articles, 7 book chapters, and has 1 forthcoming book chapter and 3 more articles under review. 2 additional books are near completion. 1, The Green Card Soldier, Between Model Immigrant and Security Threat, is based on 70 interviews with immigrant veterans. And the second, Beyond Dreamers, is based on an extensive study of undocumented college students at CUNY. I invite my colleague, Associate Dean of Academic Affairs, Gladys Schneimaker at the CUNY School of Labor and Urban Studies, to say more about this.
And also my dean, Dean Gregory Mancios. I am delighted over this appointment. Sophia's important work in immigration is central to, I think, not only SLU's mission, but CUNY's mission, but equally important is her incredible connection to our students and to her colleagues. Greg?
Thank you. Thank you.
Greg, you're muted.
I would just add that we have an extraordinary candidate here on all three counts, scholarship, teaching, and service. She's a prolific author. She's a compassionate teacher, and she's an excellent citizen of our community. So we're very fortunate to have her.
Great. Thank you so much for those comments. I move approval of item policy 1B.6. So do I have a second?
Linares Garcia.
Thank you, Myra, for the second. Any discussion? Hearing no discussion item, we will move this item, I mean. All right. Hearing no abstentions or objections, we're pleased to announce that this item has moved. Thank you that Dr. Sophia Apkenkar is granted early tenure. Congratulations all. I'm moving to policy item 1.B7, which is a resolution to award Maria Teresa Kiley with early tenure, again at Queens College, with an application of bylaw 6.2. So I call again on the Executive Vice Chancellor to provide brief comments on this item.
Thank you. Dr. Mary Teresa Kiley's scholarship on teaching, writing to students with disabilities addresses practical issues such as using technology, engaging in evidence-based practices, and exploring how teachers' beliefs impact their delivery of writing instruction. Dr. Kiley's reviewers refer to her continuous productivity in national presentations, Council of Exceptional Children annual conferences, and indicate that her work is being published in highly regarded journals in the field of special education, such as Exceptional Teacher Education and Special Education, and Learning Disabilities Research and Practice. I invite my colleagues, President Frank Wu and Provost and Vice President for Academic Affairs, Elizabeth Henry at Queens College, to say more about this proposed action.
I defer to our provost.
I would just add that, yes, her work has a real impact on teachers of special education. She has an excellent record of grants and of collaboration with a number of leading scholars in the field. and we feel that she contributes a great deal. And I would add, she also helped us with online teaching during the pandemic. So we're pleased to put her forward for early tenure.
Well, I want to congratulate Queens on these. Well, we've got a few more. So before I go there, I want to congratulate Dr. Teresa Kai. Oh no, wait a minute, I can't do that yet. I moved this item. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, we'll now call for a vote. Hearing no abstentions or objections, it's our honor and pleasure to announce that Dr. Maria Teresa Kiley has been approved for early tenure at Queens College. Congratulations, all. I now move for item 1B8, which is the resolution to award Maza Majestet with early tenure again at Queens College with the application of bylaw 6.2. I'm calling on the Vice Chancellor again, so the Executive Vice Chancellor, to provide some brief comments on this position.
Thank you. Maza Mengiste, MFA, is a published novelist who joined Queens College as a tenure-track assistant professor of creative writing in 2015, following 3 years as a visiting assistant professor in the MFA program there, as well as a visiting positions at NYU, Princeton, and Northwestern. Professor Mengiste has published 10 essays in journals and magazines, 5 essays in anthologies, and edited an anthology of fiction, Addis Ababa Noir. Her second novel, The Shadow King, published by W.W. Norton, was shortlisted for the Booker Prize, an exceptional honor for any writer, particularly notable for an untenured assistant professor. Additionally, the American Academy of Arts and Letters awarded her its Literature Prize, which honors exceptional accomplishment in any genre. Professor Mengiste has also a distinguished record of public service outside Queens College. She's also on the board of Words Without Borders, an online international journal that publishes translated literature. I invite my colleagues, President Frank Wu and Vice President of Academic Affairs, Elizabeth Henry, of Queens College to say more about this proposed action.
Yeah, I have both of her books right here, and I'm going to be shortlisted for the Booker as a young novelist is just so impressive. This is someone who is sought out and is making her mark as a novelist. Just really amazing and a fantastic teacher as well. Betsy?
Nothing further to add.
Wonderful. I really do want to congratulate you, Queens College. Every time that we see these early tenure requests and we see the caliber of the individuals that the universities are putting forth, I just know that CUNY is just growing and growing, and our academic excellence will also grow. So thank you for that. With that, I move the approval of this item. And do I have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Trustee. Any discussion?
Can I just, I'm trying to be quiet here and such distinction in all the candidates, but on this one, since I had the pleasure with Provost Henry to secure when she was a visiting faculty member and didn't have a tenure line to get the tenure line so that we can begin to put her in track and to see her blossom. And if you haven't read Frank showed the two novels, her last novel is really fantastic. So I'll remain quiet, but I just wanted to say that because it's such a great appointment. So thank you.
Yeah, well, I wanted to thank you too, Chancellor, because all of these, I've been on this committee and I've seen the caliber of this people that we're coming forth with. And I just want to congratulate all of you. And I should have said that after the vote instead of before the vote, but I move this approval of this item. So do I have a second?
Second, Leonidas Garcia.
Great. Thank you so much. We'll call this for a vote. Hearing no abstentions or oppositions, we're really proud to appoint Dr. Maza Majeste with early tenure at Queens College. And again, congratulations to all involved. Policy item 1B9, which is a resolution to award Christian Parenti with early tenure at John Jay College, again, with the application of bylaw 6.2. I call again on Executive Vice Chancellor Daniel Lemons to provide background on this, brief comments on this.
Thank you. Dr. Christian Parenti is a trained political geographer and a highly regarded public intellectual. He's written four well-received books with topics ranging from incarceration to sustainability, as well as peer-reviewed journal articles and numerous other publications. Dr. Parenti is considered an excellent department member and is dedicated to serving the department, the college, and his larger profession. He's also a currently elected representative of the Faculty Senate and College Council. I invite Provost and Vice President for Academic Affairs, E. Lee, to say more about this proposed action.
Thank you. I really don't have much to add, except I want to invite you to notice that in every external evaluator's evaluation by established scholars, the one common thread is that Dr. Parenti really combined his approach with multifaceted in interdisciplinary research. He's from, as mentioned, from economics, namely political economics, to sustainability, to justice reform, incarceration. So really, this is the person, exactly the person that John Jay College needs. And also, in addition to that, given that we educate, you know, fierce advocate for justice, his public writings has been really touted as a someone with a national influence. So thank you and for the opportunity. And we're really pleased to have him.
Thank you. Any other comments, Dr. Lemons?
No.
Okay, great. I move the approval of this item, policy item 1B9. Do I have a second?
Second, Linares Garcia.
Thank you. Any discussion? Hearing none, we will now vote. Please only respond again if you're abstaining or opposing. Hearing no abstention or opposition, this item carries, and please congratulate Christian Parenti on our behalf. Thank you so much, John Jay College. Item policy 1B10 is a resolution for transferring instructional staff from the Department of Kinesiology to the Department of Health and Nutrition Sciences, Biology, and Secondary Education at Brooklyn College of the City University of New York. This one is a little more complicated. We looked for some comments and clarification from Executive Vice Chancellor Daniel Lemons. Thank you.
Thank you. The Department of Kinesiology at Brooklyn College has had significant departures of personnel and declining enrollments over a number of years. Furthermore, the number and the rank of faculty have made it increasingly difficult to manage the academic programs associated with the department effectively. As a result, all of the programs would find better academic homes in the administration of other departments due to declining enrollments. Based on disciplinary and scholarly fit, faculty expertise, and the ability to contribute to the curriculum of the receiving department and the potential for collaborations with colleagues, the remaining faculty will be transferred to departments of biology, health and nutrition sciences, and secondary education. The faculty fully endorsed the decision to close the department and to transfer to other academic departments. Before I invite my colleagues to add to this, I have to say this is a very rare occasion that we see, but is appropriate, and I think it's a great example. So let me invite Provost and Senior Vice President for Academic Affairs, Ann Lopez of Brooklyn College, to say more about this action.
Thank you, EVC Lemons. The faculty of the Department of Kinesiology very much believe they will find homes, intellectual and academic homes, for their programs and themselves and other departments. As you know, kinesiology is very interdisciplinary, and these differences among faculty were not necessarily the best over time for the faculty themselves, for their intellectual and academic growth. And so working in other departments where they have even more in common with others really will help the faculty, you know, just bloom as scholars, the three tenured faculty there. The two lecturers there as well will find a great home in health and nutrition sciences, where they will work together on curricular matters, where they have much in common with the faculty there. So as you can see, the three different departments, biology, health and nutrition sciences, secondary education, they're so different. And these are really the intellectual and academic homes for those faculty and for the academic programs associated with each of them. So for those reasons, the department has decided that it wants to do this, and we move it forward.
So I move the approval of this policy item. Do I have a second?
Second, Karen Coughlin.
Thank you so much. Any discussion? I have a question. What is, you know, This is highly unusual, and thank you so much, Dr. Lopes, for the clarification and how this helps both the academic enrichment for the professors themselves as well as the university. But what, if any, are there the cost implications and or tenure implications of these moves?
If you can answer that. Yes. There are no tenure implications. There is potential cost saving over time in moving the faculty to different departments. As we transition and move with the programs, we hope to develop these programs further with other faculty expertise in other departments. So that will be a kind of cost saving, if you will, as those programs grow further.
Okay. Thank you so much. Any other items of discussion, questions? Hearing none, we'll now call this for a vote. Hearing no abstentions or oppositions, congratulations, you have your merger or whatever you're gonna call this, consolidation of your departments. Godspeed, Keep us posted on all of the new developments or any implications that they might have. We'll be curious to know how they move forward. Thank you so much. So now we're gonna go to item 1B11, which is a resolution for extending the period of the Chancellor's Emergency Relief Fund from its current period to extend it to June 30th. 2022. And again, I will now call on Vice Chancellor Glenda Grace. How are you? Brief comments on this item.
Absolutely.
After all our niceties, we'll get to the item, right, Glenda?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Good evening, everyone. This is actually the third such resolution that we've introduced to extend the life of the Chancellor's Fund, because we've been pretty successful through the solicitation efforts of Chancellor Matos Rodriguez and Interim Vice Chancellor Andrea Shapiro Davis. We are asking that be extended again for another year. We actually have raised over $10 million in the roughly 14 months that it's been in existence. And we believe that there is still opportunity. We know there's still need for the Chancellor's Fund. As many of you remember, just last month, you approved a gift of $1.2 million from a foundation. So we want to continue to keep this opportunity open. We just heard so much about our wonderful faculty and all that they do. And this fund helps us to allow our students to continue to finish and actually one day maybe become some of these faculty. So we really are asking that you extend the fund. The one difference is the amount of the fund. The chancellor was authorized to accept up to $15 million without for the fund, but we're asking that you extend that you expand that and make it $20 million. But other than that, we're just asking for an extension. We believe there's still need. We know that we can still help, and we believe we can still raise the money.
Thank you very much for that, Senior Vice Chancellor Glenda Grace. I want to move the approval of this item. Do I have a second?
Second, Linares Garcia.
Thank you so much, Trustee. Any discussion? I have two questions as Senior Vice Chancellor. Yes. Number one, was there any prohibition, because I don't remember, for making this fund in perpetuity, just establishing it as a fund and not having to go through these extensions and possibly maybe what we can visit periodically is the amount of the fund so that we can make sure that it is focused in the direction that it is. So if we don't, I want to propose that as something we should explore and look at so that we don't have to amend today's resolution.
Absolutely.
But is there any prohibition or any concern that we would have about doing that?
We don't have a concern, but I would note in the resolution, it changes how we're allowed to accept money. Basically, it allows the chancellor to accept up to a $1 million gift without getting permission from the Board of Trustees. And that's different from what is normal. When you look at the resolution, it states that. But we are looking into what we can do so that every year we're not coming to you to do this. We're exploring different options so that we can continue to allow the chancellor this opportunity to raise the funds to help our students. So our expectation is that you will hear more about this in the next
half of the year. Thanks, because I think I would like to revisit that and sort of like establish this as a permanent, explore the possibility of a permanent funds and also look at the terms, all right?
Absolutely.
Chancellor, do you have any objections to any of that, looking at that further?
Absolutely no. I think additional flexibility when it comes to fundraising to support our students, I think everybody can embrace that.
All right, Grace, I think we should do that, but I don't want to amend today's resolution. So any other comments or discussions on this item? Hearing none, I'm calling for the vote. Hearing no abstentions or objections, this item has carried.
Thank you so much, Chair.
Thank you. There are no more items for us to review or approve. And so I move to adjourn this meeting, and I'm hoping that I get a second.
Second.
Great. I can count on you. Any, all in favor?
Aye.
Any oppositions? No oppositions, no abstentions? Good night, everybody. This meeting is adjourned.
Good night. We're going on right to audit. Good night.